criminals who happen to be young, but not children who happen to be criminals in the first place. Therefore, we argue that under this debate, we cannot just let these children have a special exception and not be able to trial them just like an adult, just simply because of the fact that they look and have a young age in the first place. Before we move on to an actual debate, let's define a few terms, right? So the first term is dangerous youth offenders. We argue that dangerous youth offenders means that people who have the age below of the legal age, or usually in most countries, the age of 18, right? And these people are criminals who commit serious crimes and things like killing other people, rape, and stuff like that. We argue that the difference between the juvenile court and the normal court in status quo is that people who are below 18 usually go to the juvenile court, and people who are above the legal age go to the normal court in the first place. I'll argue the difference here is that punishment is usually different, and that in the normal court you are punished as an adult, and in juvenile court you're considered as a children, and you will get a severe punishment in the first place. The problem with this debate, today's debate, is that firstly, according to the status quo, the justice system has flaws, and we argue it's not always necessarily good to trial children in a juvenile court. I'll explain to you why later. And the second problem is on how these dangerous youth offenders, the crimes that they commit are very harmful, and we argue they're taking away the rights of other people. And that's why we think they should also be trialed as adults in certain cases, and we think this is the problem of today's debate. This moves into my first substantive on the idea of what dangerous youth offenders should be tried as adults in the first place. So the first level is on the idea of the difference between dangerous youth offenders and normal youth offenders. We're going to, in the case of normal youth offenders, that these people commit weak crimes, and crimes that are not so severe, things like shoplifting, things like pickpocketing. Right? We're going to, usually the consequences of these crimes are that they get fined or even have parole in the first place. But we argue that when they commit dangerous crimes, right, things like killing, things like raping, they have things like imprisonment or lifetime imprisonment in the first place. And we argue that these first and second degree crimes, they are taking away fundamental rights of other people, things like right to life and things like right to bodily autonomy in the first place. And this is why we also argue it's justified for them to be tried as adults in the end of the day. Because we essentially think that the crimes these dangerous youth offenders are committing are also crimes that adults are able to commit as well. And therefore, we argue there's no distinction why they cannot be tried in the normal adult court. For instance, this is done. Looking at the second level is the idea of judicial waiver. Within that, in the US itself, remember that there are already children who are able to be transferred to these normal courts depending on the severity of the crimes in the first place. Because within these crimes, in the end of the day, can also be committed by adults and not necessarily other students. We want to give you an example of Cameron Williams, who was a student at the age of 16, where he shot police officers, he committed robbery, and he committed assaults within other countries as well. The punishment he got was that he was transferred to the normal court and received 110 life imprisonment in the first place. However, we see that this status quo is already moving towards the idea of transferring children who commit serious crimes into these normal courts in the first place. And so mostly to my third level of the idea of informed choice. And because we argue that when these children commit these crimes, to a certain extent, they already know the law and they already know what the consequences would be if they kill someone and do these types of things. Therefore, we argue that it also should be justified to allow these people to be transferred to normal courts and be tried as adults in the first place. This leads me on to my second substantive, and before I move on, the POIs. It's moving on to my second substantive, and why is the status quo currently not working, and why is the current justice system not enough, right? So on the first level, we argue that in the past, right, people always thought that children were people who were innocent, and people always thought that children, you know, were people in the society where, like, they need to be taken care of carefully and not be punished, right? We argue that in this case, it's very different, because we argue that society is moving, and it's moving towards and it's changing. So we argue in this case, the justice system must also change accordingly. Because we think that juvenile court was created in the status quo in the first place because people thought children were innocent, they should be treated differently from adults. But we argue that in the current status quo, children are already committing crimes that adults are already doing in society. So we think in this case, the justice system should be changing also. We'll give you an example of the legalization of guns in the US. The US has decided to legalize guns because they see that the society in their country is also quite problematic, and we argue the U.S. also sees that, you know, they should give guns to citizens so they can protect themselves. But then in this case, also similar to juvenile courts, your juvenile court should also, these children should also be moved to these regular courts when they see that these people also need the same punishment as adults. But secondly, we also think that the state needs to protect every single one of their citizens here because it has to follow the social contract. And therefore, we argue in these certain scenarios, just because these children are, you know, seem young and they shouldn't be seen having any certain special exceptions in everything, because we argue the justice system cannot be rigid and needs to adapt to the current society and what is actually happening. As opposed to my third substantive, why is it going to be beneficial in the first place to move children to these normal courts, right? So the first level is on the idea of the pillars of justice. So the pillars of justice are, firstly, that of deterrence, rehabilitation, and proportionality. Let's look at the first idea on the idea of proportionality. The proportionality in the status quo already depends on the state, and the state already chooses what punishment to give according to the severity of the crime in the first place. Because within the state, when they are already doing so in the normal court, they argue in this case, why can't they apply it to these dangerous youth offenders as well? And for the law.
Yes, but they already do, because youth offenders who commit less serious crimes receive less serious punishments.
Okay, so as I already told you in my first substantive, this is a distinction between normal youth offenders and dangerous youth offenders. So because we argue that in the context where the motion says dangerous youth offenders, the word dangerous already defines that these people do severe crimes such as killing or raping that already take away certain rights of the people, and we think this is why these crimes are already on the same propensity as crimes that adults commit, so we don't see why they should not be able to move to adult courts in the first place. But going back to my substantive, right, so the idea of proportionality. So then in this case, the state should also be able to punish these kids according to proportionality, not just adults at the end of the day. And then the last level is on the idea of rehabilitation and deterrence. So then in this case, when these children go into jail, right, we argue that these people will have some psychological help from psychologists within jail in the first place. They also have recreational activities to do so that it ensures that when they come out of jail, they're able to be people who can contribute to the society and the effective citizen members within in the end of the day. And we argue this is the benefit that exists under our side only if we allow these children to move up to normal courts. But secondly, on the idea of deterrence, we think that when these people know the consequences of what happens, going to happen to them when they commit these dangerous crimes again, we argue it's going to deter them from committing these crimes again. Because essentially, we think that the mindset of these children, right, when they know that they're going to do something and there's going to be severe consequences from doing it, we argue they're going to stop doing it again because it deters them. Right? Okay, the benefit of deterrence in this case is the fact that we argue firstly where people in the society becomes more safer because it reduces crime. Because people, everyone, and these criminals be deterred from committing crime when they know that, you know, they can receive severe consequences. And that's why we're very proud to propose.
We on site opposition has today chosen to take a perhaps radical stance that there is in fact a difference between a 5-year-old and a 42-year-old, and we believe strongly that the judicial system should consider these differences as well. So to support this notion, we will present three arguments. The first argument is about the difference between children and adults. Second argument is about the effects this motion would have on these children. My second speaker, Alexander, will then talk about our third argument about how society already acknowledges and deals with these young criminals. But before going into any of these arguments, I would like to rebut points brought up by the first proposition speaker. So, firstly, they claim, they basically argue for more severe punishment for children. They believe that in the juvenile courts, they get too light punishment. And they don't consider this just considering the very horrible crimes these children sometimes commit. But however, we don't really see how this actually links to the motion. This isn't just arguing for more severe crimes for more severe punishments for very severe crimes. It is actually not connected to a notion of why we shouldn't make any difference between adults and children. They have to some extent, because that is what psych proposition has to prove. They have to prove that there is no fundamental difference between a child committing a crime and an adult committing a crime. And they have done so. They have done so to some extent. But I think a just fundamental problem that comes up then is that this would only go for the children who commit serious crimes. So on psych proposition, they have a notion that there's no difference between a child murdering someone and an adult murdering someone. But for some reason, they want to make a difference when a child steals something and an adult steals something. And we see this as a very fundamental flaw. But I will touch upon many of the reasons for why children should not be considered the same in my arguments. But they also actually brought up the point about prison being good for rehabilitation and so forth. By trying them as adults, this give them a chance for rehabilitation, a chance for making them better people. I will actually disprove this in my second argument. But we can also see that it isn't in the status quo that these children receive no rehabilitation, no punishment whatsoever. We have, for example, the juvenile facilities, which my third speaker will speak more about, and we believe these systems are more efficient when actually rehabilitating these children because they have very special circumstances. But that being said, I will now go move into my successive points, starting with the difference between children and adults, and also connecting it to the juridical system. So one of the major purposes of the juridical system is, of course, to figure out what is right and what's wrong, as someone made something right and someone made something wrong. And you can view this quite simply, like someone has broken the law, someone has made something wrong, let's punish that person. But it's actually more complex than that. Because we in the status quo, and we on side opposition believe that this is right, the judicial system actually considers, for example, your mental capabilities when they are judging your actions. For example, we don't view manslaughter and murder as the same thing. If someone has a psychological illness and did something, we don't consider that person the same way as we did someone who is perfectly mentally healthy. We consider that you have done something more wrong if you were actually fully conscious and fully aware and had all the tools society should provide you with when you took the decision to make a crime. Yes.
So you agree that if a 17-year-old youth is actually committing a crime consciously, you're going to try them as adults too?
No. Of course, I will go into later in this argument about exactly why we cannot view children and adults as equal based on both psychology and how we have constructed this society. So yes, we have in the status quo a view which side opposition supports that if you don't have the same mental capabilities to actually see what is right and what is wrong, the judicial system cannot hold you accountable to the same degree. So then let's look at children and adults in this context. And I would like to begin by looking at psychology. For example, there's a famous psychologist called Jean Piaget who created a development ladder of cognitive development. And he found out that you're not really done with your cognitive development until the age of about 17, 18, when you're considered an adult in most societies. But before this age, you actually cannot really fully comprehend, no thank you, abstract moral concepts, which are very important if you are considering committing a crime. We can also see that in young people, their frontal lobes have not been fully developed, and the frontal lobe in the brain is vital for consequential thinking.
Sir.
So we can see, no thank you, that children and adults on a pure biological level do not have the same capability to make the right decisions. But we can also just look at what society has provided for opportunities in this scenario. Because society for young people have not given them the chance to take responsibility because they have been taken care of their guardians. They have not been tested, they have not tried taking responsibility. These young people have not finished education for the majority of the cases. So they have not been equipped, no thank you, with the knowledge society considers vital for actually being a functioning and responsible citizen in this society. So we can see that when it comes to making a decision, considering, for example, whether to commit a crime, we can see that adults have considerably larger amount of tools to make the right decision in these scenarios. And therefore, we don't believe that children can be held responsible on a pure ethical level on these crimes. Yes?
We think that these individuals who make this, if they actually make this decision in a less intentional way, we think under the criminal court, they'll still be punished less, right? What's the reason on your side?
Well, because we see that there is actually a fundamental difference. For example, because you haven't finished education, because you're not a legal responsible person, because your guardians take care of you. So we see that there's a fundamental difference just because you are a child in these scenarios, and that's why we want to make a difference. No, thank you. But now I want to go into my second point about what effects this would have on the individual. Because another part which the psych proposition recognizes is to provide rehabilitation. That's the purpose of the judicial system, to allow you to become a better person. But what would happen now is that they consider you an adult, so you get an adult punishment. Most likely you would be put in the prison with other dangerous adult criminals. And youth is a time when you form your personality. It's a time when you form the foundation for your life. And now we have a situation where these young people would form their personality, form the basis for their lives in a surrounding where their reference for their behavior becomes these dangerous criminals. And we don't consider this as giving these people actually a chance to become better. And thereby, they have, psych proposition has violated another judicial principle of actually allowing you to become a better person, which we saw in their example when we say that they thought it was good to punish someone with a 110 years prison sentence. So we believe that psych proposition is heavily violating judicial principle, and therefore we are proud to oppose. Thank you.
Why is that a confusion on side opposition's case? But listen on the third rebuttal, where they say that the juvenile facilities have rehab and they're already being punished. We have already shown you how the juvenile system is very lenient, where children who commit crimes, all they get is a few months of jail time and then parole. They jump straight to parole. We don't think that if somebody kills somebody or if somebody rapes somebody, we don't think parole is enough. We think you have to actually make sure that there's a consequence attached to the crime you do, no matter how old you are. This actually shows that the state is showing one constant message that is being sent out. And we think that this message is very important in teaching these children not to actually commit the crime. But more importantly, we think that juvenile facilities don't actually have the same proportionality to the crimes. We think that when you are in an actual adult criminal court, we think the proportionality factor is there. But when you are in a juvenile court, you get parole. We think that these proportionality isn't correlated with one another, which is exactly why when a child is dangerous, we need to make sure that they're being criminalized or charged based on their offense. But let's look on the next rebuttal when they start talking about how they say that the judicial system needs to consider the mental abilities. One, we think right now, even in adult criminal court, we consider their mental capability. But right now, in criminal court, if they're mentally unstable, they get a completely different punishment as somebody who's mentally sane. We don't think just because they're a child, they're all of a sudden going to be excused from that rule. We think that rule still applies to this debate, to our model. But let's go to the next rebuttal when they start quoting a famous psychologist and saying how they need to have full knowledge. One, we've already shown to you how the child is now more fully aware of everything that's happening in his surroundings. Where we say that these children are more exposed. We think that under our side, we actually show that these children are just as capable as any adult, where the intent is still the same. But more importantly, they moved on to the fact that my third speaker, POI, that these children, they say that the children haven't finished education, so their mindset isn't fully conformed. We have seen a lot of cases where adults don't even finish their education. Does this mean they're going to punish adults differently? We don't think that's the case. We think we judge everything based on intent. When the justice system does it based on intent, it doesn't do it based on anything else. But let's, on the very last rebuttal, when they start talking about how we're actually violating the foundation of justice system. We think that we're not violating the foundation of justice system. The justice system, we've already explained to you that the pillars of the justice system is closure, rehab, retribution, and also when you actually want deterrence. We've already shown to you how, one, we provide deterrence because of the fact that we allow for the different kids in society to realize that there's a consequence, there's an actual consequence attached to the crime they're committing. This prevents other kids from actually committing the same crime. But more importantly, they talk about how because these children are so young, they need to make sure they form the foundation of life. We think that if a child is going out there and killing somebody and raping somebody, we don't want them to actually form a foundation of life based on that and say that it's okay if you have that mindset. We'll give you a lenient punishment. It's okay. We think that if you're a children, we want to make sure that you understand that the consequence of that action, you need to make sure that you form your foundation of life on the right track, not on the completely wrong track, that it's okay if you kill somebody. And that's why, moving on to our argument, when we talk about victim culture, we think that the nature of crime itself is the fact that you are inflicting harm on somebody else, on the fact that you are actually hurting the family members, where these family members are actually constantly being affected, whether or not it is a child killing somebody or an adult killing somebody. We think that these family members are still affected every single day because of the crime. We cannot completely exclude the fact that these family members are still mourning the loss, the same exact loss, as if an adult was committing crime. The problem with juvenile court is that the juvenile court let these youth offenders off easy. Yes?
Do you want a judicial system based on revenge?
We think that the judicial system is based on proportionality. It's not to exclude the fact that because you're young, we exclude you from the consequence. We want the judicial system to be consistent in the stance they're taking, that because of the fact that you committed a crime, there's a consequence attached to the crime, regardless of how old you are. That is the message that the state should send. But moving back to my case, we look at the problem with the juvenile court, where the juvenile court let these youth offenders off easy. Well, these youth offenders are not punished, there's no actual consequence. We think that these victim feelings and emotions under side opposition case are completely disregarded because of the fact 2003 because of the fact that the juvenile court isn't working. We need to actually have a different mechanism to make sure that these children aren't actually committing that same crime. So because I've proven to you how victim closure is very important under our scenario, and we need to make sure that these children understand that the consequences behind their action are actually important, because they're in the future, we want to make sure that they start off in a right track, not perpetuating constant mindset that killing is okay, that raping is okay, and therefore I'm proud to propose.
Can I call upon the second opposition speaker?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm the second speaker on team opposition here today to explain to you why we cannot see adults and youth as the same in today's society. But before I move on into our third argument on case opposition about how there's already being acknowledgement and effect of when youth commit a crime in today's society, I will address some of the points brought up by team opposition. There was a small point brought up by team opposition in the first argument on how the U.S. are giving their population guns to protect society. This is actually not the case, the reason the U.S. gave them guns. They gave them guns so they could rise up against a corrupt government in the Second Amendment when the Constitution was amended in the Bill of Rights. So this, and they just haven't been able to change this to this day. This is the actual reason that argument just falls. They also say that they see a move toward a bigger society where children have more influence impacting them, they have a bigger understanding of the world around them, with the internet and all these new influences. However, what we proved on team opposition was that even though they have more influences, they might have more reasons to commit a crime, they do not have the mental capability of taking a decision and realizing this cause and effect. This is another point that they brought up. This whole point of being feeling like, oh no, now I'll be punished, now I shouldn't commit a crime. This is the most fundamental flaw in a youth's mindset. They do not realize the whole cause and effect principle. They do not see that if I do this, this will happen. This is what develops that very last stage of brain development. So this is the most fundamental reason we actually make a difference between youth and adult, because that is the entire thing about the judicial system, that it is cause and effect. If you commit a crime that breaks the rules of society, we will punish you for it. Yes?
So didn't it for children to know the law, they don't have to have a bachelor degree to know that killing is bad?
I think so. They have not been taught about this. A two-year-old, a three-year-old, a four-year-old will not know that it's essentially wrong to kill. This is something they are taught by their parents, they are taught in school, they are taught as they grow up. Moral values is not something we are born with. It is something that is explained to us as we grow up in society. And this is the essential matter here, that they are still founding the base of their life. They are creating their personalities, they are forming their moral values and what they want to live life by. A child cannot, in all circumstances, understand this. In many circumstances, they can understand that they are killing another person, but they can't understand that it is wrong. In some circumstances, they understand that it is wrong.
Sir!
No, thank you. They can understand that that it is wrong to kill, but they can't understand that when they point a gun and pull the trigger, that they are killing that person. There are some fundamental flaws in their thinking. They cannot understand this decision-making process. They also attack the point of the juvenile system. No, thank you. About how it is more lenient and how it is just catered toward children being children, therefore they should get away with crime. This is not true. We acknowledge that they have committed a crime and therefore we put them in the juvenile system, which is catered especially to them. That system is tailored to be able to rehabilitate them in a better way than they are adults. Their mindset is different from that of a mole. Their brain functions differently. They need a different approach to actually be able to rehabilitate them. Because this is what we think about team opposition, that rehabilitation is the most important part of the judicial system. It is not the only part, absolutely not, but it is the most important part because that is what eventually leads to protect safe society. They also talk about victim closure and about victim closure is important. But we still see that in the justice system, this is a two-way street. We don't let the people who have had a crime committed against them decide the punishment. We still have set laws by society that decide if you kill someone, this is the punishment you get. If you steal an item of this value, this is the punishment you get. This is not the victim saying, like, this impacted my life in this way, therefore he should get this punishment.
Sorry.
No, thank you. We cannot adopt a society where the victim gets to decide what happens to the person who committed the crime. We need to be able to create a safer society where we set common goals about retribution, and we cannot set a case where we let the victim is impacted be the basis of the crime. It's the crime in itself that causes the punishment. Now we'll move on into our third point on case opposition. But how we already acknowledge the fact that children are committing crime. We are not letting them get away with crimes today, as Team Proposition have argued. What we are doing is we're putting them in juvenile facilities, and these juvenile facilities are vastly different from prison. Prison that is for adults, juvenile that is for children. In juvenile, they are offered group therapy, they're surrounded by people that are also children, and they are...
Sir?
Yes?
We think that at the end of the day, under the normal prison for adults too, there's still always going to be integration, right?
Of course there will be integration, but there is a fundamental flaw here, because the integration is not while they're in the facilities. First of all, let's look at the juvenile facility. They are surrounded by children. Children need role models when they're growing up. Like I said earlier, they need someone to look up to, somebody to teach them their moral values. If they're surrounded by adults who have committed crimes, we think this will be a negative influence. They will never be able to integrate back into society and be given a second chance because they have not been taught what needs to be taught to a child to become an adult. However, what you're talking about in prison, these people have already been gone through this process of being a child. And we, as we said, maybe they haven't gotten education. We think this is regrettable. That is a case in itself. That is the problem. They have not been given education, and there's not much we can do to solve this problem in the judicial system. This is a problem that can't be solved by the judicial system, but it is a problem we acknowledge. Now, what is actually happening in these juvenile facilities? Well, they are given education, they are given role models, and they are given a second chance in life. The whole purpose of these juvenile facilities is to actually make sure that these children still get out of childhood what you need to get out of childhood. And that is education, moral values that allow you to be a functioning citizen in society. If we instead only take the case of retribution and take the case of punishing people for crimes, we see that these children will instead, once they get out for their crime, or if they ever do, they're not part of society. This is a bigger harm in itself. They are not actually the citizens that we want in our society. We haven't given them a second chance because we said, what you did is wrong, now your life is over. We need to acknowledge that we today see children differently. Children are different from adults. Therefore, we have two different systems. We have the judicial system, we have the juvenile system. And then the fundamental difference here is that although we acknowledge the crime has been committed, it is a crime by somebody who does not fully understand what they are doing, and a crime done by somebody who should have the capabilities of understanding this. And therefore, we are proud to oppose this motion. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
the children have changed. But secondly, they neglected the idea of how these children, who are dangerous criminals in the status quo, are not going to be fixed under the juvie system, and they've never actually tackled the point on how the juvie system will help them better anyway, right? So we think that we already won this debate on the basis that we'll be able to help these individuals, but furthermore, we make it proportionate to their crime. But let me move on to the two questions I have today. Firstly, is the current justice system actually working? And secondly, how do we best fulfill all the pillars of justice system? So let me move on to my first question on is the current justice system working? The first thing they never actually actually acknowledge is the fact that the current justice system for young criminals is not actually present anymore because of the fact that these individuals who are dangerous are not being punished enough, right? They've been given a few months of actually rehabilitation, but they neglect the fact that these individuals still have that intent to kill, and there's no direct tackling on this point at all, right? But now let me move on to the second thing they talk about, how we apparently contradict ourselves because of the idea that we still don't agree with small crime, right? The small crimes that young individuals make is significantly different from dangerous crimes that the individuals make, right? Most of the time, pickpocketing can be easily solved by rehabilitation, easily solved by explaining to the child why it's wrong. Because in this type of circumstance, we think it's quite effective within society already on the idea of juvie systems dealing with that. But the juvie system cannot deal with a dangerous and an enormous amount of intent inside the killing, right? When you kill someone, when you rape someone, it's a different intent from you pickpocketing someone. We think in this circumstance, the juvie system has shown statistics on how they were not able to deal with this, and that's why in this circumstance, we need to punish them under the criminal court because we believe that there will be much more effective punishment and much more effective deterrence under our case, right? But in the circumstance in which this small crime becomes something that the juvie system cannot deter, we think it still needs to be, we concede to the fact that it can be moved to the criminal court, right? But in the status quo, it can be dealt with. That's why we're not talking about that at the end of the day. But let me move on to the second point on how they talked about the child is actually being punished proportionately because the child doesn't know what they're doing in these different things, right? Look, if the child has already had the intent to kill, if that child already thought that the solution to something is to pull a trigger at one of the adults that they saw, we think that there's already something fundamentally wrong with that child, right? We think that child already, usually kids already learn from young that killing is wrong, right? And we think that if they already step over that line, they killed someone. We think in this circumstance, it's already something that acknowledges that that child no longer actually acknowledges the fact that that law is there, no longer actually is scared of that law. And especially if you put them in the juvie system right now, where there's not going to be effective punishment, it's not going to be any harsh punishment against them, they'll think, oh, I can do it again because my punishment isn't going to be that bad, right? It's not as bad as being an adult. And that's why we think that the current justice system doesn't work on this ground. But thirdly, we think that at the end of the day, what's going to happen is that we think that when the child is released, you're not going to be able to help them to rehabilitate because of the fact that that child didn't learn anything from the fact that they're actually and something that they've done is wrong and deserves that type of punishment. And that's why we tell you that the current justice system hasn't worked. We need to change the system. So now let me move on to the more important class on how exactly do we fulfill all the pillars of justice system. Let's talk about the first pillar on proportionality. And this is where they brought up the idea of how it's proportional because apparently that child is always going to be innocent, right? We think they live in a very utopian world where they assume that every child is going to have a mental capacity of a six-year-old, right? We think a lot of times these individuals inside society, even if they're actually only 12, already have the capacity of an adult, right? You get to go on the internet, you get to see different things under the status quo, and it's much different from when in the 1900s where you're only being exposed, the only thing you're being exposed to is your own house, and the only thing you're being exposed to is the fact that you see something in a textbook that your adult has given you, right? The child in the status quo is much different, and that's why we think that the justice system needs to be flexible in order to move towards this type of 21st century. But secondly, they talk about how the child is not rational and that their frontal lobe is not being fully developed, right? We think that under this circumstance, right, we think the criminal court already deals with this because if we understand that that child didn't have that full intent and like full heinous ability to kill that individual, we think it's already been considered under the court right now that that child hasn't had like that really bad intent to do so. But at the same time, we already punished them harsh enough for them to understand that even if it's something that they did out of rage, it's not something that you can do. It's not something you should do because it's hurt other people and it's endangered your own society, right? And believe in. On the second idea, they talk about the idea of how the child it needs to form their personality, but before I move on. Okay. So the second thing they talk about is the idea of how the child is forming their personality. Basically, we think that this is actually quite weird, right? Because if they believe in the child forming a good personality, we think in the first place they should give a punishment that's effective. That's something that we cannot see in the justice in the juvenile system, because the juvie system is very lenient, right? They also don't actually consider any harsh punishments for that child. And therefore, children who actually kill and already neglect the law in the first place actually will not be deterred by this. We don't think that's going to happen. But secondly, we think under the criminal court, we also give second chances, right? If you actually show good behavior inside the prison itself, you show improvement in your own thinking, and you show that you are a capable citizen inside society, we already reduce your sentence. That's something that still exists under the criminal court, something we can also do, right? So now let me move on to the second idea on rehabilitation, right? They talk about the idea of how apparently juvenile system allows for these children to talk to other children in the first place. But we think in this type of situation, right? Under the criminal court, we also have that type of system where in which if you go to prison, you already have things such as recreational activities, you have psychological help, where the psychologist will be able to talk to you, explain to you what's wrong, what's right, teach you the different points and the circumstance. We think if they already do this, it's something that is already done. We think that there's not going to be any difference except for the fact that you still need to be punished harsher because of the crime you've done to create a deterrent from you. Before I move on. Okay, so let me move on to my deterrence point. We think that under the status quo, that's something that they've never proven how they're going to be able to allow in the first place, given the fact that these individuals have an intent to kill, right? And that's why on our stance itself, we believe that deterrence is something that's important for the society, because we don't want individuals to go outside and start killing everyone just because they are a child. It doesn't justify the fact that they can kill anyone, right? We think that this there's an increasing trend in children who hasn't actually understood the full consequences because of the fact that there's the juvie system hasn't actually deterred them enough. We think that this is something they need to do at the end of the day. On the last point, the idea of closure, right? They talk about the idea of apparently how we're going to base everything on the revenge, right? That's not the case. We think under the status quo, it'll be based on the proportionate compensation of those individuals, right? And we think it's important for these families because once you lost a person of that you love ever since you were young, we think in this type of circumstance, the family deserves to have their own security, that this child is not going to go outside and kill another person. That child is effectively deserved. That's something that we need to serve for society. That's something we need to serve for that family who has been affected increasingly because of that kid who wants to go out and kill other people, right? And at the end of the day, because we believe that the juvie system doesn't work under our status quo right now, secondly, because we believe that it needs to be proportionate, that individuals who are dangerous need to be served, we are very proud to propose.
They have more things,
They have more news, they have more knowledge to build an opinion and understanding of the world. But the psychology and the biology of the children's brains have not changed because of this. They have not proven this because that would be absurd. The children's brains have not changed. Yes, if their brains, perfectly, if they were more developed today, they have more opportunities to build a stronger foundation understanding of the world. But because the brain and psychology is still the same in the child, they cannot use this exposure in a way that makes them actually more responsible. Because at the core, fundamental level, the psychology and biology is still the same. Because that cannot be changed just by you watching the internet. Now they also claim that they can be responsible because the intent is still the same in a crime. No, it is not, because they are not fully developed. They do not have the understanding. No, thank you. Therefore, the intent is actually not the same. That is the point. And this is why, for example, mentally ill persons who are mentally ill are not being punished in the same way as people who are not. Because they cannot understand, they cannot have the same intent. And as we have proven with the children's mental capability, they are inherently, by themselves, actually mentally disadvantaged. Yes.
You can't exactly define when a person's frontal lobe is actually going to be fully developed. So if their frontal lobe is not developed at the age of 21, will you still punish them in duty?
Yes, you can. This has been proved. There have been studies, biological and psychological studies, for the past century about this area, and that they have proven time and time again that this is the case. That around the age of 17 and 18, the brain is fully developed as developed as it will ever be. Now moving on to the second fact that the system has flaws. Now there,
sir.
These flaws actually were has changed a bit during Team Proposition's case. In the beginning, they argued that the juvenile system will not actually be able to rehabilitate them enough because of some reason. They didn't explain why. They said, they will not be rehabilitated because we do not believe there's a person of thank you. Coming out after a committed murder from a juvenile facility will be rehabilitated. But at the same time, they claim that a child pickpocket will be rehabilitated. And they did not explain why there was a difference between juvenile facilities and a pickpocket. Or a murderer. Then after a while, they continue to say that actually the rehabilitation in both juvenile facilities and prison facilities are the same. But the point is that they should receive harsher punishment. This was primarily brought up in the thinking by the third speaker, claiming that they need to be punished harder because there are psychologists and there are some education in the prison system today. Well, now they're just arguing for harsher punishments in general. And this is just a complete confusion.
Sure.
Is the point to rehabilitate better? Is it to punish better? Yes.
That's exactly why we want them to put into the criminal court, right? Because we think that there's not enough punishment under the duty system.
Yeah. Then why shouldn't you? But that is not the debate. The debate is not why children should be punished harder. The debate is why they should be considered the same as adults. And we can fully agree that, yes, there are problems in the judiciary system, and the juvenile system. Yes, perhaps there needs to be harsher punishments, but children, at a fundamental level, cannot be considered the same as an adult. Now, they also said that, that the system itself has some flaws because society is changing. This is connected, of course, to the first point by children being responsible. They said that, when the juvenile system was created, we just assumed that children were innocent, that they couldn't commit crimes. No, we did not. That is why we tried them for crimes. That is why we had a juvenile criminal system. And they also moved on to the question of proportionality. That, within the judiciary, because these are tried in the other court, juvenile court, there is no proportionality. I myself pointed out in the POI that yes, there's still proportionality because less severe crimes, such as pickpocketing or stealing, do not receive the same punishments as crimes such as murder or rape. Then they claim that yes, that this debate is only about the crimes of murder and rape. And of course there's no proportionality between, if the debate is only about murder and rape, yes, then of course there's no proportionality between murder and different kinds of murder within the juvenile system. We're still talking about the same punishments. Furthermore, they have also
court.
Yes, but in the judiciary system, we always have to consider the intent and the responsibility,
sir,
and the thank you, of the person involved. And we have one time and time again proved that a child cannot have the same responsibility and the same intent because of their mental capabilities. They also claim that, in general, the juvenile system is too lenient. That children get paroles, which apparently adults does not, yes they do, and that they only are punished for a few months. I don't know the specific... Now, this is a specific example. Of course, there could be, as we have said, it could be improvements in judicial systems, and I suspect there's different case between countries, how long they're actually in the juvenile system. But we have never argued that this juvenile system is perfect as it is. We have just argued that the consequences and the basic principle structure of considering children the same as adults is inherently flawed and will not bring any improvement at all. Actually, would bring several, actually the opposite, which has been successfully argued by both our first and second speaker, considering the fact that children in prison will have less ability to rehabilitate, because they will, in these crucial years when they are forming the foundation of their life, will be surrounded by dangerous criminals. And finally, this is why, at a fundamental level, the principle level, that children cannot be considered the same as adults and therefore should not be tried as adults. Thank you.
And I call upon the Opera High speaker.
I think at some point in this debate, psych proposition has been a bit confused and actually just argued for more severe punishments for children. But as my third speaker just pointed out, this has not been the core of this debate. It is whether children should be considered adults, so therefore I will ignore all these points. But otherwise, I will try to go through everything that happened in this debate. So I think, the major clash in this debate is basically the motion. Should children be considered different? Are children equal to adults? And here we can actually see a clash where side proposition base their arguments on their own feelings, while side opposition base their arguments on science. They have claimed that that the children can be held responsible to the same degree because now we have the internet, now they get so much more information. However, we have so successfully argued that it doesn't matter how much information they get, because what matters is your ability to deal with that information, your mental capabilities, your consequential thinking. That is what affects your intent. And therefore, we see that children cannot be considered the same as adults. Then they have actually, when they realized they had lost that point, they actually started arguing for our case and saying that, yes, we believe that mental capability should play a part when you're being judged in court, but the criminal courts already do this. However, we can see that this is just arguing for our case. They're saying, yes, we believe that the judicial system should consider these people being children when they are being tried in court. So then their whole point is just that we're supposed to get rid of the juvenile courts, because somehow they believe that the people who actually have special education and special knowledge about children are somehow worse at being in these courts and actually treating these cases. And they went back to their old point that mental capability shouldn't matter at all, because there are people in general, even adults, have different mental capabilities. And we can agree to some extent, but it's also important to see that we have argued that in society, children are considered different. Society hasn't given these young people the same chances to become responsible people. Society hasn't given these people the same knowledge society has given to adults. So therefore, once again, we see that you cannot consider these people the same. Then we have had a question about rehabilitation, where partly psych opposition has again just argued for more severe punishments, but they also seem to believe that somehow a facility that is especially catered to the needs of children children where the staff has special knowledge about the situation for children who are somehow worse at handling these people than a prison where as we have explained, these children would grow up with other adult dangerous criminals as the role models and as the people they found their moral beliefs on. So we don't simply see the logic of psych opposition in this case. And then we have had a little small clash based upon their third argument about victim closure. But once again, this is mostly based on a belief that children should just be punished more severely, which we have already argued is outside of the debate. But then we have also argued that we cannot have a judicial system which is just based on the victim's wish for revenge. We need to have a juridical system which acts justly on the basis of society's wishes and which acts based on this person's mental capabilities. And if it's a child, it has different mental capabilities, and therefore we are proud to oppose the motion. Thank you.
And to close this wonderful debate, I call upon the proposition reply speaker.
Here.
Psychological health. sure to be fulfill the justice system. When we talk about victim closure, but victim closure isn't only to accept the fact that I am ready to accept the fact that the person that killed my family member is in jail. It's also to give that family safety and security that the person that committed the crime won't do it again because they are actually getting punishments that are proportionate to that crime. This is also the fact of victim closure. But we also spoke to you about deterrence, how we prevent other kids from actually getting involved into these crimes. We also showed you rehab and proportionality. So because I've proven to you that children are the same